the life of someone who has lived a full life and a good life. So as you come now to give your tributes, I ask you to give your tributes. I ask you to give your tributes, remembering the rules that have been established, and please try to abide by those rules. So I now invite the Long Hill Church to come. The tribute will be delivered by Associate Pastor Nydia Smelly. Do we have the Child Protection and Family Services? Then we will also have that tribute to be delivered by Mr. Robert Williams. And then I will come back to you.
Good morning, everyone. Greetings to you all in the wonderful name of Jesus, to all our ministers and all our brethren and friends and bereaved family. I express my condolence to the bereaved family. May the Lord give you strength in a time like this. John in Revelation 14, verse 13 said, "And I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, Write, blessed are the dead which die in the Lord. From henceforth, yea, saith the Spirit, that they may rest from their labor, and their works do follow them." In January 1962, Brother Kianute Francis originated from Freedom District, from the Church of God of Prophecy. As a member, he was passionate about winning souls for the Lord. He came to Long Hill District, which is about 2.5 miles from where he was living, to have street meetings. Two other brethren accompanied him. One was his sister and another brother from the same church. He also took a lamp with him, the one they call a lantern, the lamp that is with the handle that could hang up anywhere they went. Hallelujah, bless the Lord. You will understand that there was no electricity at that time in the community. When they started singing, few people started gathering to enjoy the service. After a few nights of services, he recognized or realized that there were lots of children in the area, so he started a Sunday school. A grocery shop was close by, so he borrowed some of their chocolate boxes for the children to sit on for the evening Sunday school. He still continued his street meeting in the Sunday night. In the early part of his visit to Long Hill, a lady looked at him and said, "Young man, I see where you have ambition, but nothing good come to Long Hill and stay." That didn't stop him. He continued to preach the gospel and seek soul for the kingdom of God. Some people accepted the Lord as their savior. On December 8, 1963, he had his first baptism. Four candidates were baptized in water. One member out of the four still remained faithful until now, which is Evangelist Winifred Borer, a wonderful woman of God. The second baptism was on May 5, 1964. The mission began to grow. The Lord saw that they needed somewhere for themselves to worship. They were blessed with a nice spot to build the church, and that was where it is even until now. To God be the glory, great things he hath done. He and his members worked very hard to put up a structure there. The church was organized with 9 members in 1964. The overseer at that time was Bishop R.C. Smith, and the pastor in the area was Reverend Reginald Harris, who pastored the Glengarth and Freedom Church. Elder Francis pastored the church for many years. The membership grew over the years. He was a man of faith, a prayer warrior. When you talk about fasting and prayer, both zone and local church, he was there. He was a hard worker, a planner, a builder. He was committed, reliable, dedicated, loving, kind, a teacher, a counselor, an encourager, a marriage officer, a visionary. When it comes to crusade, he was number one. You could see his van, well loaded with musical equipment, brethren on board, also a few chairs. He was a giver. He was not mean to the work of God. He didn't use church money for his own purpose. He had his wife and children, and he worked hard to. He also pastored other churches as such as Walk. When he was at Cocoa Walk, he said the building was too small, so he extended it. He assisted with other churches such as Amsha Gobe, Bambas Ridge. He wasn't a lazy man. He also served as a supervisor for Area 5 and 6 for a number of years. He was really an outstanding leader, a faithful servant. Under his leadership, he has turned out many, many pastors, deacons, ministers, and leaders. Many more could be said about Elder Francis, but it would take a whole day or a week. Elder Francis has left an indelible mark. He will be sadly missed, but he will be sadly missed by us at Long Hill. He has run the race, kept the faith, henceforth laid up for him a crown of righteousness. May his soul rest in peace and light perpetually shine upon him. Thank you very much.
Mr. Moderator, other deacons and ministers and bishops of the church, the bereaved, particularly the Hunter's family and Marvin Shaw, well wishers, good morning. Marvin Shaw, we wish to, from the CPFSA, wish to extend our sincere condolences to you and your family and the extended family as well. We are praying for your strength, and we know you're a woman of faith, so you will draw on that faith, because you need that faith and strength at this time. Now, I've never met Mr. Francis, but I have been blessed to have met one of his products, Marvisha. I almost called the gentleman Mr. Hunter. Then I said, oh no, Marvisha is married. So it's not Mr. Hunter. So it's Mr. Francis. There are many persons who we have never met. A lot of persons who we celebrate and revere. But because of their legacy, because of what they have done, it is as though we know them very well. Because I have met and worked with Marvisha for a number of years, it is as though I've met her father. We would have spoken about him on quite a number of occasions. And I know he was a man of God. He was a church planter. Yes, I know he was a pastor for many churches. And we would talk about him from time to time, because she was very concerned about her father. But I want to say in 2 minutes that Marvisha is a wonderful and awesome person. So in debt, because if it was not for CPFSA, the Child Protection and Family Service, wonderful talent, and I want Marvisha on this level. Perhaps I've never met anyone so professional as Marvisha. If you know who I'm talking about. It tells me that her father was a disciplined man. It tells me that her father believed in education. When Marvisha speaks, I have to know, check myself and call my words properly, because I would be embarrassed. Because she knows diction. She's very proper. She knows what it is to be confidential. She's a confidant. You can call Marvisha anytime, and that is it. She would punch you well. She was a deep woman of God. And I've happened to have gone to her church and to watch her worship. And I don't have to do that, because at work, once we need prayer, we know who to call. Once we need some deep something, we know who to call. Marvisha. She's a woman of God. I call her the prophet. When Marvisha tells you something is going to happen, look out. It will come to pass. And I know that her father must have been a good man to have raised a daughter who is so spiritual and believed. She was like the bedrock in the office. She was one of my managers. And one of the things about my manager, I can depend on them. And Marvisha, I know I could depend on her. She's very loyal. Now, we hear of fathers usually when they don't do what they're supposed to do. Especially where we work. So when they're bad fathers, we hear a lot about them and when they do bad things. But sometimes we need to celebrate the fathers who have been good fathers. Marvisha's mannerism and confidence tells me that the father was a good father, because the literature said fathers who are attuned to their children, fathers who pay a lot of attention and connect their children, are normally better off than the average child. Their IQ is way up, yes. They're very confident and they can face the world. That we saw in Marvisha. She never backed down from a challenge. So I knew her father was a father who connected and knew what it means to be attached. Because that's what literature said. Today, we are remembering the giant of a man. Some people, when we see what their children have done, we say, oh my, we pity them. But all that I can say, that he must be a proud father in life and in death. Because Marvisha has done very well. She had made us proud at the agency. And we continue to work with Marvisha. Even though she may not be at work at this time. But every day we would talk about her and remember what Marvisha has been doing for us. And we, as long as she's alive, we know we can call upon Marvisha to say, help us here. Because she has the acumen. Mr. Francis is gone and he will not be hearing us. But I want to say, may so my father be very well. But you are to be, as we are of you. And we know that there's nothing to be ashamed of. We grew up in the Lord. And it's the same thing that you'll be calling upon even today as you remember him in death. God bless you and thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Let us now stand for the reading of the second lesson. I invite Ms. Kimone Smith to step forward. With the reading from the book of 1 Thessalonians 4, reading verses number 13 to 18.
The second lesson will be taken from 1 Thessalonians 4, verses 13 to 18. But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that ye sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you, by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise another with these words.
St. Catherine Health Department. We will have the tribute from Mr. Linville Francis. And then the reflection, the tribute from the Riversdale District of Churches, and then I will come back to you. So please follow in that order, and please, if I stand here, it means that your time has expired.
What firm personality Daphne possesses is no doubt one of the many qualities her father. On behalf of the Public Health Nurses Special Interest Group, we extend sincerest sympathy to members of your family at this very difficult time. We pray will sustain you. His hand of comfort will give you all the settled peace now in the days, weeks, and years to come.
To me, came with me to school to collect my report. She took one look at Dada. I guess she saw the strictness on his face. Were we out? I said, yes, Lord, this is over. I'm going to be the laughing stock of school. What am I going to do? All this. first time, my dad was quiet. He didn't say a word. When he finally spoke, he said to her, "Sign the report for me, please." She stops and she signed the report. Handed it to him and he said, "Thank you." When you imagine, everybody said something good about you except for she. My dad realized. That she wasn't speaking the truth. He was a wise man. And next memory that I want to share quickly. Dada loved animals. Cat, dogs, he loved them all. We always have dogs. And in Jamaican term, we refer to them as dog cousins because anybody could just come and go and the dog wouldn't even make a sound. One day, Dada went and got a dog, a bad dog. His name was Bringle. Nobody could come in the house freely or in the yard freely. They had to stay outside and I had to hold the dog and I said, "Okay, you can come now." One day I woke up and I couldn't find Bringle. I searched, couldn't find him. So I decided to ask the person, "You see this white, you know, striped dog?" Eventually somebody said, "Yes, I saw him down by the river." So I went quickly to the river and I realized he was in a ditch. My neighbor was there who helped to take him out for me. And I took him up in the yard. But I realized the dog was bucking up in the wall, bucking up in the kitchen, bucking up in everything. And I said, "Oh my God, the dog can't seem blind." When Dada came from the bush, I said, "Dada, them blind Bringle." Dada looked on the dog and he shook his head. And I remember he took off his cap that he wore to the so laid his hand on Bringle's head. And he prayed for Bringle. Church, can I tell you? Immediately, Bringle regained his sight. You know what I learned that day? Changes things. I took a million toll. Rest in peace.
Oh, yeah. A great man, a legend. Every pastor, every member, every friend, especially my pastor over here, and every elder is one of my favorite person in the world. He is so supportive of me. You know, I can tell you that standing here now, I don't know who I am today spiritually. If it were to have an interest in music, man, a ticket to make people know, yes, this is a artist. Come look at him. You know, and he did the same thing with my brother, you know. And I remember, Elder, after I did Gospel Festival, Elder always want me to sit beside him on the rostrum. And sometimes I would come to church late and, you know, when I'm at the back of the church, him walk, come to the window, call me and say, "Up here, so you do." And I didn't understand why then, but now I to ensure that, you know, to prevent me from falling as a young man to keep me close. And so I'm thanking God that I'm here. Even standing there, the Lord one more man, just come on, serve the Lord. Hallelujah, Father, you're worthy. We give you your glory. We give you.
In the dark where I often hid my face, where is no hiding place. I've a thunder, precious Lord. storm passes by.
See it, I will tell you. Listen.
So oftentimes Satan whispered and him say, there ain't no need, no need to try. See, there ain't no end to your sorrow. There's no sweet by and by.
Somebody lift it.
See, I know.
Journey without Elder, it's not really an easy one. But with God, we'll make it. Hallelujah. To God be the glory. Thank you.
We can say go on because we know he's heading somewhere. I must say to our pastors, ministers of the gospel, my bereaved families, friends and associates, I want to say good day today. It is with painful feelings to know that my one brother has gone. But what I'm happy about is that he's not just gone, but he's somewhere. He's somewhere. And there is something that I'm glad about, is that he was in an army. And the army, as the Lord showed to me last night that he was in, it wasn't the soldier army, not the police army, but he was into a special type of army. Sometimes the soldier finds himself at a wrong place. He was not at his post. The police sometimes is at a wrong place. He's not at his post. But one thing I'm glad for, my brother was at his post, even close going to death. He said to someone, not because you see me sick, I'm in my swoon gone, But you hold up your head. Keep strong and be very courageous. It's not easy to find a man like my brother. You think everybody did speak nice and sweet things about him? He go to hell. But you got to walk to hell if you want to reach heaven. It doesn't matter what people say about you or what they do you. It matters that you keep on the journey. When he get down in sickness, I do my own investigation. And everyone that go and look for him say, listen to me. Keep sweeter here, still go on. And because of that, my brother has set a legacy behind him. That you don't have to worry tomorrow to find someone to preach in the church or in the zone where he was oversighting. You don't have to wonder, can I get a preacher? Because from heavy church, there are preachers, preachers, and preachers. But you know what he did? He made sure that he said to them, before you want to preach, make sure you live good. And if you want to preach, you have to keep a whole heap of fasting. You have to go down on your knee and pray. I'm going to say something to you. When I was small, I told myself that I'm going to be a tag rag for the devil. I'm going to do everything wicked to everyone that tried to do something to my family. Because I must be the protector of my family. But that night when I went to church, he was preaching. And the topic of the message he was preaching, remember, know thy creator in the days of thy youth, while the evil days come now. And he pointed his finger to me. Thank you to forgive me, oh God. And he said to me, my little brother, it's time for you to serve the Lord. And I give him a answer. I stood up and I look him in the eyes. And I say, my brother, you go and preach. But anybody trouble any honor, me we kill. And he break down in tears. You know what happened? When the fire reached me, I did not know. When the power reached me, I did not know. But when I came to myself, I was on the ground, fluttering like a half-dead fowl. And when I get up a new person. I get up a new person. And I was able to stand beside him, help him preach our churches, preach all over. I just want the brethren to pray for me. Because my ministry is still there. I just want to shake up and go get it back. Brethren, keep in the Lord. My believing family, my friend, I'm praying for you. Children, I'm praying for you. Because I know some glad morning, when this life is over, I will fly away to that and where joy shall never end. Oh, I will fly away. Oh, 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 I will fly away. Oh, glory. Hey, I will fly there.
I'll be him again.
Yeah. Let me say good morning, everyone. It's a privilege of mine to be standing here this morning to bring tribute of a wonderful person who has passed on, one who I find very difficult to call him. Brother Francis, Pastor Francis, but for me, it's very hard to stand in a formal setting like this and say, Elder Francis, Pastor Francis. Godfather is someone I could rely on, in that when I got saved and was to be baptized, my mother seems to be putting up a little resistance. Teen, if you don't let me baptize, and when I run away, when you hear from the shout, I am an evangelist or pastor in the church, not knowing that I was prophesying in my life. Here I am this morning as a pastor of the Church of God of Prophecy. Indeed, the journey with Godfather is one that is very very, very important to me. On behalf of the zone, as we would say, Zone 4, Zone 5, Riversdale District, as it is here and now, including Riversdale, look for United Fasting every first Monday of a month. Bless the name of the Lord. He would be there. He would be there preaching. He would be there running the crusade. He put plans in place. I would say that he is a master builder, knowing that something that needed and a whole lot molded. We want to say in the Lord, Sister Hyam. Our prayers are with you. Norfine and Marvita, the rest of the family, we are praying for you. We will never get back a elder like this elder that has passed on. I know that my Godfather was not just a man.
District of churches. We're going to be continuing with the tribute. We do have an item from Pastor Simon Francis from as well as the Glengarf district before we do the collection of the offering. So after these recorded tributes, then we'll have the Dillons and the Glengarf district of church. Remember our time schedule. Thank you.
Elder was not just out of my pastor, but he was my friend. You could change. And when the children come on to me, when I'm going through trials, how to go through trials by reading the word and fast when I'm praying. And he said, as long as you're reading the word and you're praying, you will make it through your trials. It's pride. I'm Sister Simon. Elder was not just how we're talking. Just because
you're there. He would tell me how to do things. And he's a good leader, and he don't lead one, not one person can say he'll lead him astray. He's a very good shepherd, and I want to be like him. I miss his company, everything that he does.
Elder was Dad's brother. He was Mom and Dad's best friend. And he became our uncle. Our uncle Elder was a person that gave sound advice. He became all
condolences. I'm so honored that God saw it fit that he would have Elder be a my life. I know that his life was a blessing and his memory will be a treasure. You are loved beyond words and missed beyond measure. I take comfort in knowing that your soul is at rest. I miss and love you always. Love, Allison.
I'm gonna miss Elder's voice. He had a thunderous voice so that when he prayed, he felt it. It was also a voice of peace so that anybody could feel comforted by it. I'm so glad he prayed for me, for my family, for his children, for his grandchildren, and for generations to come. They'll be benefiting from all the prayers that he's already prayed. I miss him already. Be blessed, family, and may the God of comfort bring you peace always.
I don't know how to give a sad video because nothing I know about Elder is sad. He's always happy, joyful. That's what he preached. So, if anybody should be sad right now, it's the people in here that haven't give themselves to Christ, because he know where he's going. He's going to see his heavenly Father. Where are you going? So let's just glorify his life, sing, have fun, laugh, enjoy this thing they call life, because tomorrow is not promised. Sleep well, my friend, till we meet again. One love.
He may be gone from our sight, but he will never be gone from our heart. We love him, and let's continue to pray and elevate the family.
Parish or National Overseer, Bishop Dr. Winston Leith and his dear wife, members of the bereaved family, other well-wishers, I say good morning to you all. Psalm 37 and verse 37 says, "Mark the perfect man and behold the upright, for the end of that man is peace." Today I stand here in appreciation and thanks to the God of heaven if I may say, for a stalwart of the faith, the late Ken Youth Francis. I personally was privileged to be a part of his life, as he was my pastor and my mentor. I compared his life in alignment to scriptures, and you will agree with me that Ken Youth Francis was an outstanding man of God. I could talk so much about him today. You know, even in our early years together, you know, we call those good old days. You know, Elder, as he was affectionately called, I would say, as Shirley Caesar would say, he kept the family. And today, I am not saying family, I am saying families. Because coming out of Long Hill, we have so many families standing up together. And of course, Helder was there as our daddy. We call him Dada. We have the Ballantyne's family, the Davis family, the Reed's family, the Morgan's family, the Hunter's family, the Loban's family. And these are just some of them. And Helder kept us together. And today, you know, we can be proud. I hope I mentioned the Davis family as well. You know, we enjoyed the legacy of this great man of God in terms of fellowship and unity within the body of Christ. You know, there were days we would go to church, and when church was over, we would have another service going on because of the bond that we share as the people of God. Elder had, he had many passions, but he had a passion for souls. You will agree with me. He had a passion to ensure that persons were baptized with the Holy Spirit. He had a passion for prayer. He had a passion to see that Christians live right, and especially dress right. He had a passion, you know, and when we think of Elder, his influence, it just spread throughout the Glengough and the Riversdale districts. Today, Glengough District of Churches is what it is because of the foundation that was laid by Ken Youth Francis. We have our monthly United Fastings. You know, these were, I would say, United Fasting was a must. And I would say, if you are in Zone 4 and you don't have a passion for prayer, it is not Elder Francis' fault. Those United Fasting, we would be there from 10 to 9, 8:30, 9 in the night. And Elder would just be there carrying on. Rallies within the zone where pastors would come together, the street crusades, right? Because of his passion for souls, almost every month we had to be on the road to ensure that the gospel was being spread in those areas. When I thought about Elder, he may not get a, you know, those advanced formal education as some of us, you know, may have enjoyed. But when you hear this great man of God open his mouth, words of knowledge, words of wisdom, you can say, yes, he was hearing from heaven, and indeed he was a man of God. Today I hail Ken Youth Francis as a great man of God because of his patience in dealing with persons, his sacrificial life, his passion for ministry, his zeal for the house of God. He left 8 churches standing strong in Zone 4. And I'm sure all the pastors are in agreement. I know many of them would love to be here today. Zone 4 was happy and blessed that day when Ken Youth Pastor Francis got married to Iona Francis. We celebrated, and we are still celebrating, because she stood with him and she ensured that the word of God came to pass. He finished well. He finished well. When he became weak, Iona, Sister Iona, Pastor Iona, she became strong. And she stood with him and took care of this great man of God. In closing, I must say, and when I say this, I'm saying it from my heart, I thank God. I thank God for Ken Youth Francis. I thank God. And to the family, his daughters, our Sister Grace, as we know her as, and Sister Marvita, and the in-laws, grandchildren, our prayers are with you. a good husband. God bless you. Bless you.
Thank you very much for those tributes. It is very refreshing when you can go to a service like this and people are not trying to find words to say, but can speak so clearly and freely and speak truth. It is commendable, and we give honor to God for the life of the former pastor, Kenyon Francis. Can we praise the Lord for his life, brothers and sisters? Come on, praise him one more time for his life and for what he means to all of us who have known him. I'm going to invite you to change your position for a few minutes as we take together this hymn, When the Toils of Life Are Over. During the hymn, we will receive an offering. Please give generously to the Kenyon Francis Educational Fund. Please stand and sing together, When the Toils of Life Are Over.
Over and we lay our hammer down, and we bid farewell to earth with all its cares. We shall meet and greet our loved ones and the Christ in the new Jerusalem. They can't try them.
shout of praise in his house today. Hallelujah. What a wonderful hope we have for that new Jerusalem. Do you have that hope, brothers and sisters? Yes, it's a lively hope. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for the offering that your people have today given. We pray that the cause for which it has been collected will be one that touches the lives of many, and it will be a fund that will continue to grow and grow as it blesses people for generations to come. We give it to you with thanksgiving in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated, brothers and sisters. We're going to continue with the tributes, where we now have a reflection, which is an audio presentation from Pastor Ayona Francis, who is the wife of the deceased. And then we will have The Journey, will be presented by Mrs. Narfeen Smith, daughter of the deceased. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us today in this service. God never hurts us needlessly, and he never wins to our pain. For every loss he sends to us is followed by rich gain. And when we count the blessings that God has sent our way, we will find no cause for murmuring. For our Father loves us, and he knows what is best for us. It was God's will that my dear husband, Kevin Francis, return home at the time he did. He exited the stage and turned his back on the sorrows of this world. Another human tie has been broken, which bleeds the heart in agony and pain. Yet even though his physical presence will no longer be with me or with us, there is still the blessed joy of memory. So I will love the memory of my mind to reflect on the good things we did and shared together. We were married in August 2004, which a mandate the Lord gave me to help him finish well. And so I set out to do just that, thinking that it was all about him, but quickly realized that it was for both of us, because I did not have it all together. I had some rough edges that the Lord would want to take off, and he was the person in charge. I learned so many things from him. I learned how to serve, to care, to give, and how to be humble. We set out in ministry because we had the same goal. At the time, he was pastoring three churches and director of two zones. It was hard work and dedication. He was a dedicated servant doing the work of the Lord. He was first on spot and lastly during crusades. He knew not how to separate his personal life from the church. His life was the church, and his business was the church. And of course, my coming along necessitated some changes. He was a family man, and I admired his love and care for people, his attitude to giving and sharing whatever he had. I would miss him gently chiding me whenever I did or said something that was not becoming of a child of God or glorified God. I loved discovering when I was in prayer for hours. He was funny. He made me laugh, and of course, I do enjoy a good one. He loved and trusted people and believed that everyone should be given a chance to be better. He served people and was loved by people. I know I am a better person for knowing him and for marrying him. After 6 years of marriage and serving together, his health started to deteriorate. He was diagnosed with dementia, and there were rough days and nights. Caring for him was hard work, physically, mentally, and emotionally. But God supplied me with the grace, strength, and everything that it took to help him. I gave the best of me because I got my commission from the Lord to help him finish well. In his last phase, when he stopped eating and talking, it was hard seeing him like that. But God took him before suffering came. He took him. So in sadness, I will lift up my eyes to hills from whence cometh my help, for all my help comes from the Lord. At the time of tears, I will remember, weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. I will look to the break of day. It's night now, but surely the morning is coming. Sleep on, beloved. Sleep on.
I want to say a pleasant good morning to all the persons gathered, our national overseer and wife, my local pastor and wife, other ministers, members of the family, friends, the media, the musicians. I just want to say a pleasant good morning and to thank you so very much for making this Thanksgiving service for Pastor Francis, my dad, our dad, a memorable one. I speak not of eulogy, but I speak of the journey. Colonel Constantine Francis, sometimes referred to as Elder, Pastor Francis, Dada, Brother Francis, Brother Lasty, Rev, Oni. Oh, what a joy it must have been, September 2nd, 1935, in the District of Freedom, St. Catherine. That was 86 years ago, when a bouncing baby boy made his first cry and gave his first kick. Little did Robert Francis and his wife, Blanche Termutis, knew that their little baby boy, from humble beginning, would grow up to be a mighty warrior in the kingdom of God. Growing up, Kenwood was not the easygoing, compliant child, but he was rather stubborn and aggressive. He would tell us that as a teenager, when he was upset, he would climb up in a tree and he would hide, and he would ignore the call of his mother who was trying to find him. Although a rebellious child, his mother's godly foundation and Christian principles had impacted his life. His mother, Sister Blanche, then was called the church mother, and she was the leader for the Freedom Church. At age 15 years old, a life-changing experience occurred when Kenwood surrendered his life unto the Lord. He was very serious about his salvation and determined to give Jesus his all. His spiritual growth and devotion to God was quite evident, and by he was age 20, he was appointed to be the leader of the Church at Freedom, taking over from his mother. Brother Francis was a vibrant church leader, and the call of God was evident. In 1958, at age 23 years, he had his first pastoral assignment at the Freedom Church, the place of his birth. He was one of the youngest pastors in those days. Pastor Francis knew that he couldn't manage the journey alone, so he needed bones of his bones and flesh of his flesh. So in 1959, he met and fell in love with Blanche Alita Burnett, and he was quite decisive with his newfound love, as 8 months after they were joined together in holy matrimony. Dad Kenwood was getting a bit anxious because no flowers was blooming in his garden. But being a man of faith and prayer, he got down on his knees and petitioned his father. And after 5 years, a beautiful flower blossomed. They named her Morvita Sharon, stand and pharmacist. And after 2 years, happiness came again when another flower bloomed and they named her Narfeen Christine. That's me. Dada was hoping to have May flowers, but when one did not appear, he was quite contented and did all that was humanly possible to ensure that his family and his two precious flowers would not suffer lack. Pastor Francis was an industrious, accomplished man. Pastoral duties in those days had very minimal monetary contribution, as many persons in the church and in the community was unemployed. Yet he knew that his family and the church must be taken care of. So while pastoring, he was always self-employed for most part. His occupation included shoemaker, farmer, basket maker, passenger driver, and for some years he signed up with the farm work program and cut cane in Florida. Leaving the church to work on the farm work program was a burden for my dad. This he stopped as soon as his daughters had finished college. His wife Blanche at the time was a stay-at-home mom. However, she would make and sell straw hats to help generate an income for the family. Dad was very caring. He loved his family. He loves people. Not to mention children and his church brethren, who had become his extended family. And over time, a number of persons had come to live with him. The house was always full, and Dada loved and cared for everyone, showing no partiality. Some of those persons are sitting right here today among us. Although he had only two biological children, he fostered many. A total of 16 persons had lived at our house over time. Some adults, some young adults, and some children. And I must make mention, I hope Desiree is listening, of Desiree Morgan, who was one of the foster daughters, always so supportive and never missed an opportunity to see Dada whenever she visits from the Bahamas. I know she would have loved to be here today. The call of God was evident on my dad's life. Who would refuse an invitation in the 60s to go to the United Kingdom when migration was the order of the day? My father did. Dada sensed the call of God in his Dada sensed the call of God on his life as a young man, so he refused an invitation from his eldest brother, Elijah James, to migrate to the United Kingdom to make a better life for himself and for his family. Instead, he signed up into Bible school and started his preparation for the Christian ministry. He involved himself consistently in reading and studying of the word, having family devotion, fasting, and prayer, and he was really a sacrificial giver. The early morning prayer meeting every Sunday morning was quite repulsive to us as children. We wanted to sleep and wished that I would just leave us alone. However, to this, we had no choice. We hated it then, but we thank God now for our godly heritage. We are grateful now. Back in the days, early 70s, trucks and footmobile was the order of the day for transportation. Walking to and from Crusade and open-air meeting in the district, and as was mentioned, fasting on every first Monday of the month was a routine. Walking had become quite exhaustive, so Dada bought himself an under 50 bike to take him along. Later, he upgraded to a Land Rover, which was the main source of transportation for its members to commute and the music and so on for the various activities of church. Pastor Francis, our dad, he was a transformational leader. His ministry, the impact of his ministry was so great that several persons who he mentored and fostered are quite active in ministry today. Out of his leadership, 19 persons are in ministry, 11 of whom are pastors, including his first daughter, Marvita. Yes. Pastor Francis, our dad, was a powerful, dynamic preacher, a man of the word. He preached the word of God under the inspiration of the Holy Ghost. And there were in numerous communities across St. Catherine. The result was salvation, miracles and healing, and individuals were set free. He was seen as an effective and anointed pastor. Dada was not only devoted to the church, but he loved and cared for his family. He was a strict and no-nonsense father, but caring and supportive. Even when we got married, he was there to give wise, godly counsel and lend and helping hand. He loved his grandchildren, and he loved his sons-in-law, Leon and Alford, and took them for the sons that he never had. Alfred would have loved to be here today to share in this service, but he is currently in the United States of America. Elder Francis is a household name in many communities. He's not only a pastor for the church he dearly loved, but he also served the community, from giving lunch money, financial assistance, food, resolving conflict, providing counseling, prayer, and support. A dynamic preacher he was, an apostle indeed, because 4 years after his pastoral appointment at Freedom Church, he preached and planted out the church at Long Hill, which he served over 50 years, building it from sticks and dirt to a beautiful concrete edifice. Other churches that he planted include Gobe, Cocoa Walk, Bambos Ridge, and Center Court. He was a great teacher of the word with an excellent spirit. He had great faith and was very passionate about the things of the Lord. He gave outstanding leadership as district supervisor to the district of Riversdale and Glengarth, formerly Zone 4 and 5. He fostered a high level of cohesiveness among the churches. Pastor Francis believed in service to his community. Although his formative learning years was at the Long Hill All Age School, he attended many other courses to upgrade himself for ministry. Most marriages in the community in those days were done by external marriage officers, as there was no marriage officer in the area. Dad signed up and applied to become a marriage officer for the island of Jamaica, in which he was successful, just so as to be able to offer marriage counseling for the communities in which he served. This he did faithfully until his health started to deteriorate and he had to surrender his license. His wife Blanche predeceased him in May of 2003, and Dad knew that he could not manage the journey alone. He later met and fell in love with Iona Campbell, a vibrant member in one of the churches that he had planted. And they were joined in holy matrimony, 28th of August, 2004. Please stand. Please. Right. She joined him in Long Hill in the current ministry, and they serve the churches faithfully. She has accomplished her mandate. And Iona will tell you that God has assigned her to help the man of God finish well. And this she executed until her last day. Pastor Francis has an active ministry for over 54 years, from 1958 to 2012. He has touched the life of many and left an indelible mark. He has fought many battles and overcome many struggles during his ministry, but with fortitude he carried on. The chorus is, I am determined to hold out to the end, for Jesus is with me. And down on my knees when sorrow rises, I talk with Jesus, was two of his favorite. His active ministry began to decline in 2012 due to ill health, and he became sometimes confused and disoriented. However, Dada was very powerful with prayer and encouraging others. As time progressed, his mental and physical health deteriorated, and my sister and I realized that it had become quite challenging for his wife Iona to manage his care. So Sister Gray was employed to assist with his care. They both took excellent care of him until the very end. We thank you. About 3 months ago, his ability to speak and walk had significantly declined, and he had to be cared for in bed. A few days prior to his admission at the Linton Hospital, he was unable to swallow and he becomes dehydrated. They tried to encourage him to swallow, but it was not possible. On Sunday, the 10th of October, he was admitted at the Linton Hospital for treatment. He was responding to treatment, and we were looking forward to taking him home. His wife, Iona, was getting the room painted while I was heading to the hospital to discuss, to have discussions regarding his release for home on that fateful morning, Saturday, October 16, when he passed on. He took his final breath and made his transition for his eternal reward to be with his Savior. It is really, really hard to see my father go. He has fought a good fight, and he has kept the faith. His life is a blessing, and his memory is a treasure. May your legacy live on, my father. The hope of glory today is my consolation. Your soul is resting at peace, and I will see you in the morning. The journey has completed, leaving his wife, Iona, daughters, Marvita, son-in-law, Leon, and Alford, granddaughter, Anisha, Kimon, Crystal, and Jody Gay, grandson, Shay and Zohar, sister, Diana and I, Vincelina and Fidelin, brother Linval, nieces and nephew and other relatives, church family and friends. A gentle giant has gone home to be with his maker. I thank you.
Thank you very much, Sister Narfeen, for that reflection that took us on that journey of the life of your dad and our hero who has gone ahead of us. We want to move quickly now to receiving an item from Mrs. Novlett Ballantyne, who will be rendering a musical item. After which, the next voice you will hear will be that of our national overseer with the sermon. As he comes, I ask you to rise to receive him.
Bless the Lord. Hallelujah. I wanted to bring greetings to all the bishops, pastors, and the bereaved family, especially my pastor, I greet you, and the daughters. All brethren and friends, I greet everyone in the sweet name of Jesus. Can I take this out?
Okay, bless God. I greet you all. This song was requested by Sister Narfine. It's called When I Wake Up in Glory.
When I wake up, wake up in glory, my Lord, and to Jesus I sing redemption story.
Thank you.
a very somber reminder of the future. For those of us who are living our lives to please God, you may be seated. When I wake up in glory, each time I hear that song sings, tears flow from my eyes freely. Two things. It arouses my senses to the fact that it's a reality that one of these days we're going to wake up in glory. Number two, I reflect on my father's ongoing service where I requested that song to be sung, and it evokes in me the hope that not very long from now, this also will be my reality. And so each time I hear it, it brings back memories. I use this opportunity to greet our day's moderator, Bishop Dr. Junior Headland, Parish Overseer for St. Catherine East, and also Administrative Assistant to the National Overseer. Other members of the officiating team, Bishop Jonathan Aiden, Senior Pastor for the Life Center Tabernacle, Minister Carl Bryan, Associate Pastor for the Church at Nagawed, and his wife, Sister Denise Bryan. Other members of the clergy, Sister, may I say, Iona Francis, wife of the deceased, Sister Morvita and her family, Sister Narfine and her family, other members of the Francis family and well-wishers, and those who are viewing via Facebook Live or YouTube. I stand here this morning with some level of confidence that one of these days, this will all be over. And to use this opportunity to greet you well. And before I get here, I spoke with Bishop Dr. Clayton Martin, our General Presbyter for the Caribbean and Atlantic Ocean Islands, and he asked me to tender his love and condolences to Pastor Iona Francis and the members of the family. He wished that he could have been here, but his borders are still closed, and so he sends his blessings and assurance of his prayers for you. Time is already spent, and I have just a few minutes. Anybody know our parish overseer know that he's a man of time, so I need to speak up, shut up, and get out of the lectern so that we can go to Medarest. But 1 Corinthians 15, verses 12 to 19, which I will not read because of the sake of time, reminds us of six things that Paul spoke to the church at Corinth about the resurrection and the hope of the resurrection. For it was in situations like these that he had to write to the church at Corinth, because so many of the brethren and loved ones within the area of Corinth was dying at a very rapid rate. And I was saying to someone just yesterday that since April of this year, after our national convention, we have actually sent home at least 12 of our former pastors and ministers, and the countless numbers of family members who are going home. And it reminds me how near we are to the return of the Lord. But the fact that death comes in between brings such a void, brings such a vacuum, brings such pain and awe to the families who are bereaved. But while we celebrate, we have to have some level of respect to the grieving family. And my task here this morning is to give you some hope that one of these days we are going to be reunited with your loved one. So Paul wrote to the church at Corinth to remind them of Jesus Christ,
who was the first fruit of them that slept and rose again and is no longer dead but is alive and well. See, Jesus had to come in order for you and I to have eternal life. To have eternal life, my brothers and my sisters, eternal life cannot be enjoyed in its fullness in a temporal body. While we enjoy some level of eternal life here as Christians, the fullsomeness of eternal life is to be with Jesus Christ and God our Father. And therefore, this fleshy body that is subject to sickness and death and pain and confusion cannot enjoy eternal life in its fullest. And so Paul wrote to the church at Corinth to remind them that Jesus Christ is the first fruit of them that sleep. And if Jesus himself died and rose again from the dead, then those also who live for Christ, like Elder Francis, will also rise and live again. The truth is that the scriptures is replete of memories of those who die and rose again, but they died again. Amen. In the book of 1 Kings, we are told that Elijah raised a young boy who was dead, the widow's son, but he died again. Elisha, when he died and was buried, his body rested on the bones of someone who predeceased him, but he died again. That's resurrection. Hallelujah. In the New Testament, we heard of Tabitha, the 12-year-old who died, and the family was in mourning. Such young life gone. But Jesus went to the home and called her, and she answered, and she lived, but she died again. The widow who was about to bury her only son, the one who would take care of her because her husband predeceased her, she was going to bury him out of the city. And Jesus saw the pain and the anguish on the widow. He stopped the procession, touched the lid of the casket, and the young man raised to life again, but he also died. We read in the scriptures where Lazarus, Jesus' friend, died and was buried for 4 days. And when Jesus came to the home, he said, "Show me the place where you laid him." I want to let us here know that in Jewish tradition, 3 days dead, no life, there is hope for you to rise again. But after 4 days, when rigor mortis set in, there's no hope for you. So the crowd began to laugh and mock Jesus. But Jesus said, "Show me the place where you lay him." And he went there and he called him by name and says, "Lazarus, come forth." But he also rose, but he died again. But I have every confidence this morning that Jesus the Christ, the Son of God, who rose after 3 days, he's no longer in the tomb, but he is with his Father, and he is the one that we worship today, and he's the one that gave us hope today that tomorrow we can live again. Today, as we reflect on Elder Francis's life, the journey for him has come to an end, but his legacy lives on. Amen. Before I tell you a few things why Paul wrote this text to the Corinthians, my reflection of Elder Francis went back to 1992 or 1991. As a National Youth Director then, I was invited to a youth weekend retreat in Long Hill. And man alive, I've never seen so much young people at that time. come together in one place, sleeping on benches, sleeping in the tent, under the leadership of this man, this unsung era of our time, an apostle, a prophet, a man of God who nurtured those lives. And today we have pastors and ministers that came out of that group today. I revere him. Yes. I went to look for him, Bishop Edlandman, myself, a few months ago. And when I saw him and saw what he was then and reflected on who he was before, I said, thank God for the resurrection and the body that Jesus Christ has prepared for us. But let me hasten to say here that in 1 Corinthians 15, verses 12 to 19, Paul preached, talk about six things. One, if Jesus did not raise from the dead, then preaching of Christ would be senseless. So I stand here to tell you that if there was no resurrection for the dead, Elder Francis would have wasted his years. Number two, Paul said in verse 14, faith in Christ would be baseless or useless. So all that we talk about, Elder Francis exercising faith, if there was no hope in the resurrection, then that would be futile. Number three, Paul says, all witnesses and preachers of the resurrection would be liars. And I refute that. Why? Because Jesus rose from the grave, and therefore we are witnesses and testament that there is a resurrection. Number four, no one will be redeemed from their sins. So when we talk about him getting saved at age 15 and started to work in Long Hill and Cocoa Walk and the regions thereof, I want to say that would be futile if there was no hope in the resurrection. Number five, Paul says all believers who have been predeceased, Elder Francis, and him would have wasted their time. Now you think of all the prophets and all the apostles and the elders of the past who have stood in faith and spoke about Jesus. All their messages would have been no effect if there was no hope of the resurrection. Sixth and final, all of us who profess Christianity, and Pastor Francis would be most pitiable, because if it was only in this life only we have hope, we will be of all men most pitiable, Paul says. The reason I use this text is to encourage the family members and those who are associated with Elder Francis. Don't give up on what you have started. Don't give up on the journey that you're on, because one of these days is going to be culminated in the fact that the trump of God will sound and Jesus Christ will come riding on a cloud, and those who predecease him and those who are alive and remain in him shall be changed, shall be caught up to be with him. The believers don't have to fear death because of the hope of the resurrection. We embrace death because one of these days we are going to be with Christ. Just as how he rose from the dead, which is a prototype, we also will rise up. The difference is, it's a mystery. The man that don't know Christ cannot understand this. Because Elder Francis will not be going to Dovecot or Midrest. No. Elder Francis is already in the comfort of Jesus Christ. His spirit that lives in him, that we know, has gone to be with the Lord. The earth remains will be going to Midrest to be laid, because from the dust he came from and to the dust he must return. But the breath he is going back to him. And so one of these days, spirit will be reunited with a body that is transformed. A body that will not suffer pain. A body that will not see corruption. A body that will not see disease. A body that will not degenerate. A body which will not grow old. Hallelujah. And so the hope we have today is in the resurrection. Finally, Paul went on to say in verse 50 going down, and I love this because it also gives the believers the understanding that death has no power over the believer. Paul says, "Oh death, where is your sting? Oh grave, where is your victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved, be steadfast." Sister Iona, Sister Morvita, Sister Norphine, and family members, be steadfast, be immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your labor is not in vain with the Lord. My brothers and sisters, the hope of the resurrection makes all efforts and sacrifices for the work of the Lord worth it all. No work done in his name is wasted in the light of the eternal and glorious reward that awaits the believer. And so Ella Francis, in all his years of church planting, preaching, nurturing, caring, shepherding, is not in vain. Even though to the last of his life he suffered immensely in the body, but the body that has been prepared for him will be a glorious one. Finally, the psalmist David says in Psalm 116 verse 5, "Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints." In Revelation 14 verse 13, the New King James Version says, "Then I heard a voice from heaven saying to me, write, blessed are the dead who die in the Lord from now on. Yes, says the Spirit, they may rest from their labors, and their works do follow them." The hope of the resurrection, my brothers and my sisters, gives us the opportunity to live with Christ. So even though we will suffer in the flesh, we will feel pain in the flesh, looking to the future where Jesus Christ will come to receive us, gives us the opportunity to continue. I pray your strength. I pray your comfort. I pray your peace. But as we wait, let us wait in hope, for the resurrection is coming, and we will all be with Christ. God bless you.
Thank you. Let us give thanks to God for the hope of the resurrection. Indeed, we have that hope. I'm going to invite the congregation to stand as Bishop Jonathan Hayden, Senior Pastor of the Life Center, Church of God of Prophecy at Gordon Penn, come and offer prayers for the bereaved family. If the family member chooses to remain seated, that would be fine. If you want to stand, it would be fine as well.
Almighty God, our Father and our friend, today I come before you with thanksgiving in my heart. I come before you with praise. I lift you up today because you're the only wise God. I lift you up today because you're the King of Kings. I lift you up today because you're the all-powerful one. Today, Lord, we are in a little bit of grief And Lord, I come to you on behalf of the immediate family. Lord, I know the grief, I know the pain, I know the feel of this time. But God, you are God, and you promise in your word that you will comfort those that mourn. Oh God, you sent the Holy Ghost to comfort, as a comforter, to comfort the brokenhearted. Oh God, we thank you this moment that you, oh God, remember your people. And today, God, I pray in the name of Jesus that you will strengthen them. I pray, God, that you will cover them with the covering of your spirit. Give them the assurance that you still with them, and that you will not leave them. You will support and you will comfort them in spite of the fact that the loved one is gone. I pray especially, oh God, for the wife, oh God, of Brother Francis. I pray that you will strengthen her. I pray, God, in accord for the daughters. Oh, God, I know, God, the affection that they had for their father, and that they feel, oh, God, the burden and the loss and the sorrow in their heart. But, God, I pray in the name of Jesus that you will stand by them. I pray that you will comfort them. Give them the assurance that one of these days, if they will be only faithful to the end, they will see their father, they will see their husband, they will see their brother, they will see their sister, their loved one, their sister will see him again. Father God, I pray that you will do the blessing. Dry up the tears, dry up the brokenness, because you are the comforter, you are the comforter, you are the comforter. And I pray, oh God, that you will do the work. Have your own way now, as we look to you and we give you thanks. We give you thanks. We give you thanks today. We give you praise today, oh God, because you are the comforter. You will give them the assurance that you are with them. Have your way now, Jesus, in your own way.
Amen. Please be seated, brothers and sisters. We're going to be, thank you very much, Bishop Hayden, for lifting up the family in prayer today. We should have a viewing, but I understand the body is not here, so we may not be able to have that viewing, depending on what I've been told. But we're going to go ahead now and bring the service to its close. I will give you further instructions because musician, just give me a number here. Let me do a little bit of clearing up of this.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, musicians. So, as I told you, the body should have come here for us to depart from here, but that is not going to happen again. We have to go immediately. Well, we'll have to go to the burial place. So I apologize for those persons who will not be able to participate in the viewing, but this is circumstances beyond our control. Please remember the deceased, like you see his lovely photograph in front of you. Let's make the best of the situation as it is. So when we're finished, there is refreshment, that is a grab-and-go refreshment. If you have been invited to participate in that, then please do so. The 15 persons who are to go to the burial, we will coordinate with the undertakers and meet them at the place of the burial. All right? Understood? Thank you very much. Thank you for your cooperation. Let us stand now, and I invite our lovely singers. Did you enjoy the singing and the music? Yes, man, rich and good and lively music. Let us now invite our singers and our musicians to help us with this closing hymn, Sing the Wondrous Love of Jesus. It will not be a recessional hymn, but rather a closing hymn. Please stand.
Sing His mercy and His grace in the mansions bright and bright. Set you prepare for us a place when we learn get to hell. What a day for justice that will be when we all see Jesus. We will sing and shout for victory.
Keeper and sustainer of life, physical and eternal, grant to your people present, especially those who grieve, comfort and hope. Let the days ahead be filled with new realities that will produce new life and give hope to all those whose eyes are set on you through Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior, and our soon coming King. Let everybody say,
Amen.
God bless you. Please refresh yourself.